If you like crazy experiments, then you're in for a treat, because we are building an Alexa 65 size sensor from any camera.
Large format or LF image acquisition has been around for a long time, and it made its way into modern times with the Hateful Eight, parts of The Dark Knight, and Dunkirk, and of course in its digital form using the Alexa 65, like in Rogue One, Solo, Netflix Dark, and The Revenant. And it truly looks gorgeous. So tell me, Leonardo, how would my camera look if it had a sensor as large as an Alexa 65's? And is it worth it? We are going to do a little math and build a crazy rig that will allow us to reposition a smaller sensor behind a medium format lens. We will then compare the large sensor against the same framing with the original sensor size.
So it's a crazy project, and if you're interested in that, come along. Large format or LF, why do we want it? Why do we need it? Well, the resolution seems to get higher and higher and higher. And it seems like the real resting point for the delivery is going to be 8K. The industry is already there and it's more or less a done deal. Now, we don't want to cramp more and more and more pixels on the same sensor size, because our effective image quality would drop. We would like to keep the sensor size about the same. The best solution is just to make the sensor a bit bigger. And this is where the large format or LF comes in. Many of the bigger players already have cameras out there, like the Alexa 65, for example, or the brand new Alexa LF, and of course the Red Monstro, and Kinefinity now brings out the LF, but which is only a full format sensor. But according to the definition of it, you could call it an LF because it's a larger format than the standard S35 for cinema acquisition. Let's focus on Arri here for one second, because Arri did something very interesting, and it's quite similar to what we do today. Arri didn't develop a real new sensor. They took the old sensor, the LF3, that has been in the Alexa since the Alexa 4-3, and they put it on the side and doubled it. And put together, we have a larger sensor with a larger field of view. In case of the Alexa 65, they take three to each other to cover something that is close to 65 millimeters, which again is very close to the 65 millimeter cams that films like 2001, Lawrence of Arabia, or the Hateful Eight were shot on.
Unfortunately, I don't own an Alexa, so we'll take the next best thing that I have in reach, the Panasonic EVA 1. Instead of an EVA, we could have used a C200, C300, FS5, FS7, F5, Ursa Mini, well, you name it. The same rules apply. Most common today is an ASPC or Super 35 sensor that has a 16:9 or wider DCI aspect. So we will need to turn that sensor vertically and move it in a very controlled fashion horizontally, so we can cover almost the same area as an Alexa 65 sensor.
Now we're gonna have to do some math. The EVA 1 has a quite high resolution to start with. So let me read that off, please, otherwise I'm gonna get crazy. It's 5760. Times 3072 pixels. Quite a bit. It's very close to a 6K image. And we're gonna put this, like I said, upside down. And we're gonna put it four times next to each other. And as the math shows, we are very, very close to something like 12K. Actually, you don't need to have an EVA or even a Super 35. Image sensor. You could, for example, use a GH5 with a speed booster that will give you a Super 35 sensor with a 4-3 aspect, which is actually pretty cool, because you wouldn't need four like we need with the EVA, but only three portions of or doublings of the sensor to get the same effect, just like the RS65 does. Or you could take a full frame camera, like for example the Sony A7S or the upcoming Lumix S1. This will allow you just to double the frame to get the exact same effect. The 12K image that we produce is going to be downscaled to 8K, and this whole thing, this whole episode is uploaded in 8K to give you the best possibility to watch the content. To match with the other things, all the other parts of this episode are recorded in the EVA 1 5.7 ProRes RAW and upscaled to 8K. I don't expect you to have an 8K screen or anything like it, but I still hope it's worth it to get the best possible viewing quality for you. Please tell me in the comment if it was worth it or not. So let's start with the rig. We are going to need something that lets us reposition the sensor with micrometer precision. A cheap macro mount will do the job, but it's important that it's a two-axis system that not only allows adjustment in the distance, but also along the focal plane. We are going to attach our camera the most convenient way that will allow vertical shooting. Now we are going to need a lens that has a large enough image cycle to cover our 65mm sensor. The obvious choice on a budget is a vintage medium format lens. I'm going to use the Mamiya Secor C, and with an aperture of f1.9, it's one of the fastest medium format lenses ever built. You would usually use it with an adapter, but we need the camera to be able to move relative to the lens, so we will do something else. I own an auto bellow system for Mamiya, and with some minor modification, we can get ourselves a free floating mount that we will throw on an arm.
One thing is to say about the Mamiya lenses. These are manufactured in the 70s, and you shouldn't expect an optical performance that you are used from, like a modern lens from Sigma or from Canon or from whatever. You have to close it down to 4 to prevent strong chromatic aberrations, but we do so, and I think it's quite a charming image that you get out of these vintage lenses. Let's try it.
We know that the lens should cover the whole travel distance of the sled, but to be sure, let's build a little cool framing checker. Cut out some cardboard. Now draw the desired frames with the exact measurements on a bit of diffusion paper and glue that to the cardboard. When we point the lens toward a bright background like a window and set it to infinity, we can put our frame checker to a distance where the image behind the lens appears in focus. As it was to be expected, the lens covers the huge 6x5 image cycle and offers lots of headroom for our 65mm frame. We assemble everything on a heavy-duty rail system for stability and position the lens accordingly.
So this is obviously no way to shoot your next feature movie. This is absolutely designed to be shot under lab condition, and if you want to shoot something that is in movement, it should be a movement that is looped in itself and repeats itself. If you have an object that crosses the different segments, it can be synchronized. Anyhow, for this test, we're gonna use a 16mm projector, and you will see that works quite well. And I even take a little bit of a risk by adding some haze.
Now we are ready to shoot, so let's do it. As we can't be precise with the pixel, we are going to cheat and just do 5 segments that are overlapping. Also, I made some markers on gaffer tape to tell me the sensor size and the desired traveling width. After we shot all the segments we need, we are going to throw the footage into After Effects. We simply spread the segments to the places they belong, add some feathered mask to disguise the transitions, and apply a grade. So, let's see what came out of this. besides the pixel peeping and the technical aspects of grain and resolution and benefits being able to crop in, does it have a real life emotional quality to it? And for me, I would say like, yes, it gives the image some extra dimensionality that gives it something very cinematic that is beyond the lighting and a grade, which I didn't really do in this test. Just by itself, it has a perspective on things that just by itself add a poetic nuance to the image that I find very appealing. I would like to hear what you think about it and if an LF sensor is actually worth the production cost that it will have.
Of course, there are many applications where a larger sensor doesn't make sense. For example, if you're in a broadcast studio, talk shows, or if you do sports, because a larger sensor will always make it more difficult to focus. But I could see that the larger formats gain some traction even in areas where you wouldn't think about it right now. For example, like wedding filming, videography, or events, etc., because the focus assist and out of focus features may improve in the future. I hope you found this interesting, and if you like this, please give me a like, give me some comments on how you use this technique, and of course, subscribe to my channel. I really appreciate your support. See you around next time. Bye.